פודקאסט מכבי תל אביב עם פרק מיוחד, הפעם לא ניתוח של משחק, אלא אורח שמצטרף אלינו לרעיון, אבל ברשותכם נעבור לאנגלית, because I want to say hello and welcome to Patrick Van Leeuwen. How are you?
Fine, fine.
Hi, Patrick.
Hi.
Feel good?
Perfect. I'm in a good moment. I'm relaxing, I'm enjoying football. And there are periods in life, and especially in life of a football coach or a football manager, that you always get offered a break, if you want or not. And this is the period that I'm in now, and trying to fill it with football, trying to discuss about football, trying to meet different types of let's say, football-related people. And yeah, I'm enjoying it.
We haven't seen you, I haven't seen you for a while, but we did saw you on the last couple of weeks watching some games of Maccabi Tel Aviv in the youth department, and we saw you watching, I think, Hapoel Petah Tikva on the Ligat Ha'al. What are you doing in those current days?
Well, let's say the period I was first here in December, Israel was one of the countries that's still playing football. The rest of the countries is taking a break. So I try to use that period also. And yeah, I like to be in Israel. I like to enjoy the life here. This last week I also gave a presentation to the coaches of the pro license of Israel. So more or less sharing knowledge at some moments that I can. Doing it here in Israel, doing it in Poland or in the Netherlands. So this kind of things keep me busy at the moment.
You know that I spoke with some guys on the youth department of Maccabi Tel Aviv, let's say around November, and I asked them if someone is checking what is up with them, with the youth guys, with the players, and they told me that you called some of them in the youth department and asked them if everything is okay during the war, and that.
Well,
they appreciate it a lot when
I try to be in touch with them. You have some coaches in the academy that still reach out at some moments or for football questions or to check how life is going and how the new club is going. So yes, it's not only returning the favor, but it's being correct to the people that assisted you in developing a youth department. And with some of them, I'm more in touch with Ori David. We have regular contact, speaking and discussing about football, watching games together. So these are the things that come out of a long period being in Israel.
I remember in 2021, when there was the firing rockets from Gaza, you were at the beach. Like, it didn't really affected you. And you came here during war.
What no, this, at that time, it was the period of war. A lot of foreigners leaving the country because it was... for them a new situation. For me in that period to be the head coach, I don't think you can leave the ship. And you
it's
need
happened
to,
before.
You need
it's
to be...
No. Yeah, he did the semi-final against Maccabi Haifa without the foreigners.
Yeah. Yeah. So this was not in my mind. And I didn't have the feeling at that time, and I don't have it, let's say now, that you are under threat. I think a part of the country...
You don't feel scared.
You don't feel it. I don't feel scared. I think that the Israeli army is doing a good job in that to take away the feeling of being afraid and continuing your life. This I knew from situations before, that there were smaller threats. But also in my experience, let's say it helped me living in the last 2 years in Ukraine by having it having the knowledge and not to be nervous about it.
Where is safer, here or in Ukraine?
I think that both the countries are doing a good job. The start of the war in Ukraine, I wasn't. I came in summer. So the bad part for the Ukrainians, I didn't notice. So the moment I stepped into Ukraine again, it was already more of an organized, safer situation with at some moment some threats.
Maybe we can say that where people see a threat or fear, you see an opportunity.
I don't see, especially if I'm on the job, that I can leave my job for this. I don't think that it shows leadership if you move out. I think that it comes with the position, and I think also that it shouldn't come from you. if the club really thinks or the government really thinks it's unsafe what we have here, we want all foreigners to leave, then you create a different situation. But if it's my own choice, then I prefer to continue the job. And especially if the situation where I am is organized in a safe way. And that time we moved away from Tel Aviv and trained in Netanya. So at that time, just 20 minutes was already a more safe, safe area.
Yeah. So we see you now in Israel. As you said, you've been here before, you came back now again. Is it to see football, maybe to learn new things about football, or is it just you missing Israel on the personal level?
I think it's both. I like to keep in touch with the people that I work with, how the development is going. I like to see also the development with my own eyes. Are players making the progress that you want? Because a lot of players could play in Europe. So this is always on my mind. So in the way that I work outside of Israel now, Israel is like also a scouting opportunity for me to see players that or grow from youth into professional players or the younger professional players that I worked with to see if they can make a next step. One of the examples is Eduardo. Yeah. Another example is Novatus that didn't make Maccabi first team officially, yeah, but was with me in the training camp at that time. And yeah, for that reason, I knew the player and I brought him to Shakhtar. Also and Eduardo to Zorya, yeah, more or less.
You also knew Stav Lemkin when you took him to Shakhtar.
No, I didn't take Stav Lemkin to Shakhtar. Stav Lemkin was on the list of the Shakhtar scouting. And
you know him from...
When I came to Shakhtar, they asked me to speak with the family because they had a feeling that I maybe would be against his signing. Because at the time I started in Maccabi Tel Aviv, they come to Hapoel Tel Aviv. At that time he was injured. They asked me like all the parents do in Israel at 15 years old, they think they need a contract. So I refused for the simple reason that at that time he was injured. I didn't have a good view on him. They left. So in that whole period, he developed himself in a different club. And for me, if Shakhtar has him on the radar as a scouted player, as a talented player that showed qualities in Mundialito and in the under 21 and in the main national team, then I cannot be against it. So this is also this is just a coincidence of me coming to Shakhtar and him being scouted by them.
We will get to the other
but it's nice to know that like he had some opinion about him,
yeah,
and then he can change it because you know he developed to be another player for him.
Yeah. That's right. We will get to the players that was with you on the U department further on, but I want to ask you before, Maccabi Tel Aviv in the recent days appointed Gadi Brumer as the academy director. If I remember correctly, he worked on your youth department?
No. His brother worked with
his brother.
Was in the begin period in Maccabi Tel Aviv. Okay. Yeah.
Was there any chance that you will come back to that position?
No.
Maccabi?
No.
Why not?
Well, for that you need to get a question. And what I said when we a little bit spoke before the podcast is that I'm still under contract of another club that finishes soon. So for me, the urge to start is not there. And also to let's say, coming from a head coach position, to step back into the youth department.
No, but not now, like in the future.
Oh, in the future, I don't say no to this kind of opportunities, especially if there is talent and if it's in a club that wants to correctly invest in the youth department.
I must say, because I know a little bit, like when he was in control of everything, like in the Yacht Academy and everything. And I must say that everything was organized. All the coaches know what to do in training, how they go to the match. They have a strategy of everything. Now you think that, as you see Maccabi, I know that you were yesterday in the game against Maccabi Tel Aviv, under 19. You think that now, as you see Maccabi Tel Aviv, it's not your first time that you see Maccabi Tel Aviv under 19. You think they do the same things?
Same principles that you
gave? No. This is not the case. And this I recognize on the field in a different age, because in the whole period that I was on and off in Israel, I saw also under 16 or under 17 games. So I try to see the different levels, how they are progressing. And I think that the way of developing talent is differently than I see it.
I'll explain it.
Well, I believe that from a good organization, a child or a coach has the opportunity to grow because he doesn't need to think about it. So that means that his mind is focused on football. If I take that part away from a coach, it means also that the coach doesn't need to think about that part because he's more or less obligated to do certain things because that's the philosophy of the club. And the club wants to go in a certain direction, and there you have the coaches that assist, and there you have the opportunity for players to become better. When you are working, let's say, for Maccabi Tel Aviv, one of the leading clubs in Israel, then you know that a lot of things will come by itself because you will have more talent than any other club. That's simply because of the logo and the attraction of the club. But you need to manage it. You need to bring it all in the same direction. To get a team, to get a philosophy, and at the end to get an end product to come into the first team. And for that you need to take decisions, not by the coach, but by the management, or by the manager of the academy, or by the manager of the football department.
So when you saw the under 16, under 17, under 19, you recognized that there is no, like, someone leading the path for those teams?
I think it's visible that coaches learn something in, let's say, in all the years that they are in Maccabi or that they entered Maccabi, that there is a certain professionalism in coaches, but that I think there is a lack has been a lack of control on the people to push them to a higher.
But I see that there is not the same philosophy.
Okay, but this can also be a philosophy from the person that comes after.
Ah, okay.
If it is connected to mine, no. Because I think that we educate children in school for a lot of years, let's say, in being better in mathematics or in English or in any language or any subject, that I look a little bit the same way to football. I don't think you learn everything in 3 months, in 4 months, in 5 months. And that there need to be a certain basic understanding of football before you can make another step or another development or another tactics. And that is by age or by level that you're playing on.
When you see the guys that grew up in your academy now becoming the top players of the Israeli football, of course we can speak about Daniel Peretz or Oscar, mm-hmm. but we also see now in this Maccabi, Dor Tourgeman and Roy Revivo, mm-hmm. and others. And now you see the new, let's say, Maccabi Tel Aviv Academy. What goes through your mind on the personal level?
That I think that the boys that are now in the first team or that moved away from the first team to play abroad, that they had a decent foundation of making the step into professional football. Because they knew that what was done with them was also with the intention to bring them to the first team. There was no other, let's say, thought behind it. We needed those players for the first team to be ready. Which is more or less a task of any academy director to bring the players. Yeah. And at Maccabi Tel Aviv, it was at the beginning very difficult because, okay, the thought was there was no quality. Slowly, every year, there was quality or players returned to Maccabi after being on loan. So you saw that more or less in that period, things that just happened started to happen with an idea.
Yeah.
Players were developed with an idea. Players were sent on loan with an idea. Players were loaned to the second division all in one team with a certain idea, which guarantees for me a higher percentage of players that are ready for Maccabi first team.
When you were the head coach of Maccabi for 10 months and you started the season after winning the cup, you had an option to decide which guys like that will stay in your team and which will go out for loan or will be sold. And you stayed with Daniel Peretz. It was your decision to make him the first goalkeeper at that season.
Mm-hmm.
And you stayed with Eduardo Guerrero.
Mm-hmm.
But as we see now, the other guys and how they developed, maybe it was not enough there wasn't enough players coming into the team from that group of players, like Ido Shachar was sent on loan, and Oscar stayed another year in the youth. Maybe it was right for him to get up before.
Yeah, I don't think so. I think that a lot of the development of players is also done on the background. If, let's say, one of the advantages for Maccabi Tel Aviv was, when I moved into the head coach position, is that I knew all the academy players, let's say, from 16 years old, that were able to train or should be able to train with the first team. So when there were difficulties or injuries, for me it was easy to call the coach or the manager and say, listen, give me the left winger of under 17, I need a left winger. Or the same with under 19. I think a lot of the development that, let's say, fans don't see or club doesn't see, is happened on those days. Okay. For me, on purpose, in international breaks, knowing that 6-7 players would move to the main team, 3-4 would move into the under 21, meaning you have a gap of 10 players. So that means that you need to continue the development of another 15 with the help of academy players. And at those moments, to bring in players from the academy was for me a pleasure, because I could just fill up the spots that I needed with talented players that I knew should be able to train with the first team, and to have, let's say, have the purpose of developing, continuing the fitness of the other first team players.
But can you explain the idea of taking a guy like Ido Shachar and sending him to Hapoel Haifa at that time, instead of keeping him inside your team at that moment?
No, it was not a discussion in the way of that he should move out. The discussion is always with players like Ido or Nadav Nidam. Can we give them enough minutes for them to keep the progress?
Yeah.
Also, another problem is parents or agents, because I can tell as a head coach, listen, train with me for 6 months, be quiet, be every day on the field, do your job, get better, and you will get your chances like that. Because that gives an opportunity for a player to get used to the professional level, to show to the head coach, listen, I'm not different than, let's say, the experienced midfielder. Yeah. Because that is that's decisions you have to make. Do you keep Yeni or do you bring Ido Shachar or do you keep Nadav Nidam? And this is something that players at some moment, some understand, say, listen, I stay 5 months, I want to fight for my chance. If I don't play, it's my decision, then I have the winter transfer window. But most of the time, players are pushed in a direction. You need to play, you need to have minutes. We need to make sure that you play. For some players like Ido, he made at that time he and Bar Cohen went earlier from the under 19 to Beitar Tel Aviv at that time than other players. Normally,
only
they
one season on the youth and then they get
So they make the step. So that means also that you need to make sure that you continue the development of those players. And at that time, if there's not enough minutes and the player has, let's say, the urge to play professional football, then you need to find the right way for him to develop.
I think that when he go to when he went to Hapoel Haifa, it's a good.
It was a good loan because there were
because
in
he played.
Position.
Yeah, and there is a lot of center midfielder in Maccabi Tel Aviv, and it was a it's not easy competition. But in the year after,
you put the blame on Ivic more than.
I think he should take him and like to made him play even more than Glazer.
Can we say that maybe in the way that you saw football, Maccabi Tel Aviv is more like, let's say, Real Madrid than Barcelona, and how they are putting the guys from the youth inside the first team?
Well, I think
because we will not see player at the age of 16 like Lamine Yamal or Kubarsi play for Maccabi Tel Aviv.
I see
it in Barcelona, but yeah.
Yeah, I think that an Israeli 16-year-old is not as far as a Spanish 16-year-old. So that is a huge difference, and that's purely because of the country. Spain having 120 million people living and 5 million playing football, and here it's a lot less and a lot less children playing football and adults playing football. So to be a 16-year-old and making your debut in Maccabi Tel Aviv, it means also that you need to have the qualities to stay directly. And I think that the youth, the level of youth football is not that strong that the 16-year-old will be ready for the first team. I think that I'm always afraid that 16-year-old Will we send out after a few months, and that you don't see him anymore. So I rather make a slower development with having more guarantee of the player staying in the first team.
Because we are touching the subject, I want to ask you, because we are already in the subject, we got ahead of the questions. In your season, when you started the preseason, the camp and everything, the training games, you had a game against Apol Kfar Saba.
Yeah.
And you took Oscar.
In an international break, yeah.
Yeah, and he scored in that game also.
Yeah.
A few months after you left, came Mladen Krstajic, and he put Oscar on the first team for the playoffs of the finish of the season. Mm-hmm. And a lot of fans and media people asked, how is it possible that we haven't heard the name of Oscar before? I mean, he was here. He was in the club. You know him better than us. What made you took the decision that he needs to stay on the youth level on that season?
I think they made already their official debut in a Toto Cup game.
Yeah.
So that was already before that. And that is the whole group, more or less, that is now coming into the first team. And
but isn't Oscar is your Lamine Yamal, let's say like this? Wasn't he like that?
Not at 16.
He should be.
No, not at 16.
Sure.
In 16?
Yeah, not at 16, because let's say like this, Oscar always played up, played always with 1 year older. Yeah.
Until the under 15.
In the under 15, I decided that I think it's the best that he doesn't move to the under 16 because of the size.
Okay.
And I don't want the player to be left out because of the size. So there are two things. Or I let him play under pressure in the under 16 and tell the coach, you need to play him, which is an opportunity.
Yeah.
But I took the decision and said, listen, Oscar, and it was, I don't want to say it tough, but to explain it to a child that always played up and is considered as being talented, to explain him, listen, stay in the under 15, stay with your age group, be the best every day, be the best every game, because that's also a way of developing, because his mentality is not to slow down.
Yeah.
So I'm not taking a risk that he will become lazy, mm-hmm. because he will only do more. And that was the decision at that time. And I think it was the perfect decision for him to also start believing in himself, to dominate the games and to be the best. Because that was the moment where he started to grow in all facets of football. Not only the football part, but also the physical part. So it started to come a little bit together where you could start recognizing this is the one that most likely, in my opinion, will make it at 18 years old. Because then he will make the next step. He will be under 17. He will go to under 19. And from there, the moment will come that he needs to start making his debut. And more or less that plan worked. And he was on the verge of making his debut. And one of the things that before I started the new season after the first 6 months was one of the, requests from the club. Yeah. We want you to bring more younger players slowly into the squad because you have developed them. And Oscar, Dor Tudjman, Revivo, a lot of other players, Guy Mizrahi at that time, also players that made already, let's say, a move from under 19 to second division, slowly to bring them inside.
Yeah.
Because there was a lot of talent. And there still is a lot of talent.
Yes.
I must say, from my point of view, okay, I was coaching against Oscar,
mm-hmm.
so it was like you can do nothing against him. And when I know that under 15, when he was playing with the year that mm-hmm. bigger than him, he was also like he was the top goal scorer in the team. And the year after, he stayed in the under 15, as you say, and every year he stayed with his team, with his age, and it was like not. His quality, for me, when I saw him, I must say, for my opinion, when he was like in the under 17, under 16, he was like a player that can play in the first team, not in Maccabi Tel Aviv, but maybe in the second division.
Okay, but this is a different subject. There are two things that you don't know of as a coach of another team, is that outside of him playing in his own age group, the matches, he's training with the under 19, or as under 15, he's training with the under 16. As under 16, he's training with the under 17. So there are decisions in his development that still give him the challenge of competing with others or with older. And that happened every year. So his challenges were always there. But it was not in an official game.
Yeah, I know.
It was in training sessions with older. It was in training sessions with the first team, or it was in friendly games with the under 19 or with the first team. These are things that are happening.
Yeah, but on training, when you see Oscar against players that like bigger than him, and you see the quality that he has, I don't know. From in my opinion, I think that he could like play in the second division when he was like 16.
Showed it in that same season.
Okay, yeah. But this is your opinion.
Yeah, in my opinion.
And if you would have worked for Maccabi Tel Aviv, you worked for a smaller club. So for him to
worked for Maccabi, but
before. So a lot of people.
If I was his coach in the under 15, under 16, I would tell you immediately, take him up.
Yes,
it doesn't supposed to be.
And you touch now one of the problems in Israeli football.
I don't want to win games because of him. I want him to get up.
No. But you are not looking at what is the best in development. And I think that the development has to come from taking the right decision. If it's for 3 months, it's for 3 months. To just send talented players up, Israeli football loses a lot of talented players in this way. So you are responsible. The excuse of the army, it's a fake excuse.
It's
an excuse is the development, the way coaches are approaching football, the way coaches are approaching talented players. Because what would stop you as a coach of a talented player to give him extra attention or to ask for extra? And the other thing I want to tell you in this is that too many coaches think they know the philosophy of the club. If an academy has an academy director, he's the one to take that decision, not the coach. Yeah. Because he's the one that is looking for the long term, or he knows that the first team is not waiting for this player. So I need to find a different path for him to develop. But next summer, I can get him into the training camp. And this is exactly the steps I like to make, not only to predict, but also, as I said in the beginning, not to get players back to the academy. No. If you deliver a player to the first team, it means he needs to stay, or he needs to stay or go on loan
I'm with you.
From this.
I'm with you totally. I would never say it like on Revivo even, or on Ido Shachar or something. Everything was perfect. But with Oscar, I think that Maccabi, the first team of Maccabi, could like have him more, or to see him more. Like the fans can benefit more from him.
I don't agree. I don't agree in this. I think that the moment he started now, let's say, to make his debut in the first team, was the moment, because he didn't return to the youth anymore.
But we spoke before.
And still, there were moments that I think the coach that so-called made him debut in professional football, didn't play him for 10 games also after that.
No.
So there are moments in a young player's development that it's all or too excited, or he gets an overload of training. And Oscar likes to train. So that means that every day he will be tired, as if he needs to be with the adults. And I think that you need to protect also. But to recognize the talent is not difficult. Yeah, and there's a lot of talented players that didn't come to the first team of Maccabi Tel Aviv, also in the period that I was not there, that I'm surprised that they didn't make it didn't get the chance.
I want to ask you, like, for Maccabi Tel Aviv, the different of Oscar to Maccabi, what the difference like from Gavi to Barcelona, or from Lamine Yamal to Barcelona? You don't think that like they are in the same age, they play like for Barcelona. It's like the best team, supposed to be the best team in the world.
Yeah, no, one grows up in Spain and one grows up in Israel. That's one. The second is that I think in that time, Barcelona probably also evaluated or scouted Oscar. And
they
didn't make the offer.
Only after they got the offer from Red Bull.
So, yeah. And if you look at choices that he could make, he made the best choice for his football career by going to Salzburg. Yeah. Because he's playing in a team that wants to dominate the games, but is also playing a little bit in a physical way. So he needs to continue his development at a young age. I think they made the right choice, and that he now comes at a stage in his football career, that the next step should come.
Yeah, I want to ask you as an academy director, because you are the one that is leading the path when you got that mm-hmm. position and you did it in few clubs. I want to speak about coaches. It's difficult, and we see it in all football. We broadcast a Liga, we broadcast Serie A. There are not many coaches who are the protagonist, who knows how to dominate the game and how to lead the game and how to be the one with the possession and how to do the build-up. And when you came to Maccabi Tel Aviv Academy, did you recognize that the coaches that you have in that academy knows how to do it, or they are more the one that reacting to the game?
Well, my impression of the coaches before I started to work at Maccabi Tel Aviv, I was let's say 6 months before that, I finished the job in Kazakhstan. I was invited by Jordi and Martin Bain at that time to give my view on the academy. So I spent a few days at the Maccabi Tel Aviv Academy at that time and gave my findings to the management of the club at that time. I think that a lot of coaches were doing their own thing. And one coach is influenced by the first team coach. Another coach is influenced by YouTube. Another coach thinks that he's the Pep Guardiola of the under 15s. So you have too much of own ideas. And I think to what I said also, to develop players, you need a philosophy for a few seasons to be sure that it comes out, and also to be sure what his best position will be. And I think that is one of the things that I noticed, that some coaches had their own idea about how to play football, which was not always beneficial or for the long term or for the players, and especially not for the club. So I think that if you analyze clubs that, let's say, have been known to develop players, speaking about Ajax, speaking about Barcelona, speaking about Manchester United for a long period, speaking about some of the Eastern European clubs, is that are the examples that you need to take a look at. Okay, how much time did they take to develop these players? Did the coach or an academy coach have his own idea, or was there one idea of developing the players? And this is something that is difficult for coaches that are not, let's say, from a leading football country, to accept that somebody comes in, walks in, a foreigner, to tell them what to do. And this is something that that I believe strongly in, and which also, let's say, made me successful in developing academies and developing teams for a longer period.
I must say that I really like your way of football, the 4-3-3 and the rotation in the middle, and that you have two players on wide on the line, and the way as you see football. Just I want to have one question that I want to know, like, why do you prefer, from what I know, like the wingers with the strong foot on the line?
If you want an honest answer, I think it's a stupid question.
It's a stupid question?
Yes. I know that Ras started this on Twitter or whatever.
Okay.
You are so funny in this that if I put Cohen on the left and Eduardo on the right, then why is it like that? Why not? If I have a striker like Perica that is also good with the head, do I expect Cohen to give me a cross with the right foot or Eduardo? So that's one.
So I see different.
The second is that the style of football that at some moments you want to play is deciding. For me, 4-3-3 is deciding. Play with one controlling midfielder or with two is a choice I make. It's a choice that also an opponent forces you to make. To play with left-footed or right-footed opposite is a choice that you make. The funny thing is that this question never comes when I play with Cohen and Joses, two left-footed ones. It doesn't come when I play with two right-footed ones.
I'm not saying this about it.
I mean that the choice of wingers depends on how you want to play. Do you want crosses for Perica, or do you want short combinations with Eduardo or with Elon Amok?
But you have them both. If you have like the wing-back or the full-back, he can make the cross. The winger can shoot.
Yeah, this is your choice of tactics. It doesn't come from the fact that I have a left footed or a right footed on the wing. It's the style of play that you want to do. The overlap will come with the right footed player or with the left footed player. So that means also that the cross gives me two opportunities from the right footed winger or the left footed winger or from the one that makes the overlap.
But you don't have enough, if the, them both, like if there are two left foot on the left side, okay? So you can't score, they can't like shoot to goal from there.
But that's your choice as a coach, and this is my choice.
Yeah, I understand.
And this is these are the things that that are not.
The reason was because you wanted the crosses to Perica. This is your okay.
Yeah. No, not the Perica. Take for example the first month that I did.
Yeah.
When then we played Beersheva for the Super Cup, Blackman scored a goal because of a good action of Eduardo until the end, and him being able to give the cross with the right foot. A left-footed player would have not given me this. A left-footed player under pressure on the right side can never deliver a good cross. He will always control the ball. So a defender is always, if he reads the moment well, he can always wait for that moment that he will control the ball and then find the ball or find the moment to tackle. It's choices. It's a style of play. It is something that one season, let's say Guardiola plays with opposite winger. The other season, he plays with the left-footed on the left and the right on the right. It is choices. It is choices. It is choices that coaches make.
Yeah, but when it happened, I don't remember when Guardiola like played with some winger on the right foot in the right side and the left foot on the in the left side. I don't remember something like this.
No, but go check it. It's with Sterling. Or if it's with Mané, or if it's with Grealish, or if it's with
they're always like on the opposite side.
They're not always like
sometimes like Foden on the left side. He put him now, but it's not like usually if one side he put like with the opposite side. In one side, if it's for sure like or on the right or on the left, he put like opposite for sure.
And for me, honestly, I don't care. I don't care. It's the choice. It's the choice that you make. It's the availability of players, and it's a moment in developing your team that is there. It's an opportunity, and I don't see it as an extra, let's say, discussion.
But what you prefer? This is. It's true that you prefer that, like the strong foot on the side. That if I'm a right strong foot,
on the line.
You prefer me on the right?
No, this is not not correct.
Ah, okay.
Because in Zorya I played with opposite. I played with same side.
Oh, so in Maccabi you play someone opposite, but
same side. I play with opposite. I play at Shakhtar the same. It's everywhere the same discussion, in the way of and part comes how the player grew up. Did he grow up on the right side or did he grow up on the left side?
The choice was also for the academy.
The discussion in a player is sometimes because simply he played for 4 years on that position and now a coach tells him to play on the other side.
What I'm saying, what I tried to say in the start when you say it's a stupid question, when I spoke with like coaches that was like coaching in your Maccabi Tel Aviv in the Yad development, so they told me that if I want to put like my winger, if he was like in the right foot, if I want to put him on the left side, so you said tell them no, only on
correct,
the
correct. Correct.
So this is why.
This is part of a bigger plan.
Yes,
this is part of a development.
Why I want to say why.
This is the why.
Because at the end, they were allowed to change sides, to let players change side, to give the signal to the players to change side. If a player is not, let's say, giving his best or looking unhappy or he has some pit bull that's killing him on that side, okay, go 5-10 minutes to the other side, come back into the game. And starting, let's say, if we speak about football development, for me, there are certain things players, coaches need to do. And that means also that there is no other option. That means also that not only the player will be, let's say, brainwashed, also the coach will be brainwashed for his feeling. But it is part of the bigger picture that I want first one philosophy to be inside everybody's head. Before I started at Maccabi Tel Aviv, without one training session, without one moment of them showing me something, I told them, this is the way you are going to play. This is the way you are going to train. everybody is going to do it. You're the coach of under 8, you do it like this. You're the coach of under 19, you do it like this. And this is the way I think to start. And that means that, okay, I don't need to be the popular guy. I'm not here to be the popular guy. Yeah. And that means also that I have to stop people from doing their own thing. And to get in that direction, you need to be ready to lose people. And I lost coaches. And I know that when you start to develop players and the philosophy, you will lose people, you will lose players. You should never be afraid of that, because the next one is waiting, or the next one is waiting to be developed.
Yeah.
So that is something that is part of my philosophy, that I like to develop not only players. I like to develop a philosophy that is there for the club and that guarantees, let's say, players for the first team. Yeah. But that also more or less gives opportunities for coaches to grow into professional football coaches. And some like to be a specialist in under 15. Some like to be in under 19, and some have the ambitions to go into adult football. And this is something they will find out. But one thing will always stay, is that the coaches that grow up in a philosophy like that, for their personal philosophy, go in the same direction. Go in the same direction of developing football, in believing in it. It stays with people because it's an organized, structured way of looking at football, which is assisting you and making life easy, not life difficult.
I must say that you benefit a lot from your philosophy, also for wingers, because they know how to go forward. If they have like the strong foot on the line, so they have the possibility to go forward. If you are in the opposite side, they try with the technique like to get into the middle. Okay, so it's better to for the game, like if you want to take it forward, but the creativity, it's like you don't think you lose something from this, from the wingers. You don't think that they lose something, all the things that one on one, the dribbles, everything.
No, I don't think so, because I'm not looking at the point of view that from the 25 players in a group, let's say in a youth team, 25 are talented. I think in every group, and this is something I took from a long time, my aim as an academy director is to deliver 4 to 8 talent, and for at the end, for the head coach and the sport director to make the choice which one we keep, which one goes out, which one we can sell. And this is the way I look at it. So the two players that are overly talented, like the Glochs or Revivo or Tujman, they will find their way. Yeah. But they will benefit from the discipline and the demands that they have every day. Players like Roy Revivo or Nidams or Shachas, they benefit also from putting their energy into a system and knowing my teammates are responsible for certain parts also, instead of going all over the place.
I want to put the academy discussion behind us. Just another two questions about it. You had a strong view regarding what you allow your players during contract discussions.
Yeah.
And you lost talented guys because of that. Guys that wanted a release to Europe.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, Apoel took you at that time. It was Lemkin, but you just came. It was also Omer Senior. It was Tai Abed, I think, on that same discussion. Maybe Osher Davida. I don't remember the Davida story.
No, Davida was already gone before me.
Okay. But you lost some guys on that. Also to Petach Tikva, I think they took you some guys because of that. When you look back on that retrospect, do you think it was still the right decision to insist on them not getting the release clause to Europe?
Yes. There are two things for that. First of all, I think that Maccabi Tel Aviv puts a lot of money in the academy. So that means also that Maccabi Tel Aviv is taking charge of the development of let's say, the son. That means also that before I came, because that is one of the things I try to reduce or to take out, is that parents need to pay. Because if you pay, you have a feeling that you are in charge of your son's career. Hmm. Because I pay you to develop my son. So that means that I need to get something back. So that more or less was one of the things that changed directly, is that from a certain age,
you don't
players are not paying anymore, Maccabi Tel Aviv takes charge. You train extra, you get extra coaches, you don't you only have to come, you only have to show up. That's one. The second thing that you take away also directly is the feeling of parents thinking they are in charge of their son's career. The players mentioned by you, for me, they were not on the list of top talents. So being let's say evaluated as not being a top talent, my advice to a club is differently. Worth it or not worth it? I think that salaries shoot up to be 18 years old should not be important, because you are willing to develop.
You're right.
My remark to parents was always, why you don't ask me why my son doesn't train extra? Why parents hire a psychologist? Why parents hire a fitness coach? Why parents hire a technical coach? Why parents need to hire a mathematics teacher extra or something? Why you don't demand this from me? You want my son to play football 8 times in the week. Make sure that all these things are arranged and then you have him. The age of 15 in the ruling in Israeli football is an age where some of the parents go crazy. Speaking about, okay, my son, football is finished, football becomes business. I want this amount for my son and I want a contract. Okay, if you then confront them with your son is not a talented player, so we're not going to pay you money, but he can continue his development within the club. And if he does well in 1 year, 2 years, and we want him to offer a contract, we will get back to you. And some parents try also to play training in a foreign academy. Yeah, I'm sorry, but if a club puts so much money in an academy, it is a very unpolite question to ask for your son to train somewhere else.
Yeah, but this is a deal breaker because I think that...
Why is it a deal breaker?
In Israel, it's a deal breaker.
No,
it's a deal breaker in Israel, yes.
Yeah, only in Israel. Yeah.
But what I want to ask, like, you prefer to lose them, all this kind of talented, and to another club in Israel, like to Hapoel Tel Aviv,
I'm sorry, I don't care.
But no, you said something else. You said that in those moments, when there was the age of 15, you didn't saw them as top talent.
Yeah.
The names that I mentioned. Yeah. Tai Abed wasn't...
Tai Abed is a different story. Okay. He was injured. He broke his leg. He was injured for 6 months. Mm-hmm. And we just simply told him, listen, get fit soon. First play in the under 16, and we'll get back the moment that you are playing. Okay, if then the parents think, okay, sorry, my son broke his leg. Thank you very much for the medical care, but we go to another club. It's something else. It's their decision. It has nothing to do with giving them the money. It's purely a point of view of football development. You have been injured for a long period. Show us that you are fit again, and we get back on the table.
And it was about money, because I know that Hapoel didn't like bring them money. No,
they just gave them the
offering, the opportunity to go to play abroad, like to play in Europe.
Just the release for free.
Well, that is maybe what they tell you. But I'm telling, I was part of it. Yeah, okay.
The other side.
That means that you are not informed correctly, because the simple fact was he broke his leg before.
No, not about Abed. I'm saying about Senior and Lemkin.
Okay, but listen, with all these names, we can speak about names. The point of view of parents is, my son turns 15. You need to give me money. If not, I go, no, okay, well, yeah, I'm sorry. If I don't think at that moment that, and I'm responsible for it, to advise the club not to do it, then I have my reasons for that. And I don't think I'm wrong in this way.
That's only because the under 15 rule in Israel? I mean, it wouldn't happen in PSV.
No, but the question would not come in PSV.
Because?
Because the compensation starts at 12 years old.
Okay.
So to pay... And the amount is different. If you need to pay after 4 years of, let's say, Maccabi Tel Aviv, $100,000, you think he will even call? No, because he knows he will not get $100,000. So simply the ruling is creating, in part of the parents, even in the not talented parents, a moment where they think, okay, my son can get some money.
Okay. Do you have any regret on your time on the youth?
No, not one. In this case, players come and go. I think that at all times, Maccabi Tel Aviv had talented players to reach the first team. Some generations are more talented. But I think, and that's why I called the number 4 to 8 talented players to deliver. I think this should always be possible to come from under 19 and even better in a solution of an under 21 team. You should make it possible to have 4 to 8 talented players to make the squad, yeah, and some of them to make the first 11. Yeah.
I want to take you back to the 2020. It's the COVID time.
Yeah.
You took the team to the training camp in Jerusalem, if yeah, I remember correctly. And then Georgios Donis came to be the head coach. Things didn't work out. You took the job near December. Mm-hmm. Then came the amazing run. At that point for you, when you saw the opportunity to become the coach of Maccabi Tel Aviv, did you thought it will be your direction for the next years also?
Well, let's say like this. The first, what was it? We started, I think, around 20th on a Monday until the beginning of August. I think we finalized the two State Cup matches at that time, the Super Cup.
20th of July you started.
The Super Cup was on 2 games at that, yes, time against Beersheba. Yeah. And at that time, Barak and me, we had some talks with different coaches. And more or less we were not joking, but looking at, okay, what will happen? We have only a few days left. Mm-hmm. And it's okay, bringing candidates to the owner for them to decide. And Barak looked at me and said, listen, Patrick, if it goes wrong, you need to start the season. Because then you are the only candidate that we have for us to start the season. Can we offer this? I said, listen, if this is the only way, of course I do it. I'm here. I know the players. I know what they have done. I said, but you have to imagine that I want to do it my way.
Yeah.
So don't tell me what to do or tell me to play with 5 or whatever. I said, I'm not doing it, because I saw it as an opportunity to show the academy coaches what we are doing for this whole period in the academy.
Can work on the first team.
Will work in the first team also, because this is the way you speak with coaches, yeah, and the way to show them that it's possible. So this is what we were doing. Okay, there was no coaching staff. So at that time I said, okay, then the two coaches, then the 19 head coach and the under 17 head coach at that time, Ori David and Eliezer, I said, you guys will assist me. And yeah, more or less we decided this on a Sunday, and on Monday we needed to start. Mm.
Okay.
So we started, and okay, you meet the team. Everybody knows, of course, yes, it's for the moment until head coach is coming. And I explained also at that time, I said, I'm here to make you fit for the season, and I have my ideas. And some of them, of course, had our younger brothers in the team, so they knew what could happen or which direction it would go. And we started to work from the first day with playing football and playing a different style of football, because that was also, I told them also that time, and I also said it here in the coaches in the IFA, I said, I'm not a fan of 5. Mm-hmm. I will play from 4-3-3. Whatever happens within the 4-3-3 is a possibility. I said, done by you or done by my decisions. And we started to work. And I try to implement all the things we were doing in the academy, from the team sessions to line training sessions, to work individually and to do more or less in the combination with Yossi Zigdon, the physical coach, to make sure that the team would be ready for when the coach was coming.
And you won the Super Cup.
The most important thing for me, Raz, was that we changed the style of football.
Okay.
Within 1 month, because we try to press, we try to play higher.
It's not easy. It's taking 3 or 4 months.
Even though it was a champions team.
Yes.
Okay.
But it was also a team that played more from defense than from dominating with attacking football or with high press. Mm-hmm. So this is something that we did in the academy, and what I wanted to try to do in the first team. That was the intention. It was not the intention to stay the head coach for a longer period, because otherwise they could have taken the decision directly, more or less.
So you knew from the get-go that eventually there would be a coach.
Yes, because I was involved in the interviews with different candidates.
You recruited Donis?
We can say. No. No. You cannot say this. Okay. No, because at the end, Barak and I spoke with the candidates, and at the end, it's the owner and this representative.
You gave a good recommendation on Donis to the.
We checked. Let's say the things Barak and I agreed on football needs to come from 4-3-3. We want to play an attacking style of football. Yeah. We want to implement younger players.
It was much more fit to Maccabi Tel Aviv than so, Donis. That's what I can say.
So this this was our intention, and we spoke with different ones. And okay, at the end. People need to
you enjoy to
take the decision about
you
us.
Enjoy the 3 months with Donis.
No, I want to ask if you enjoy to be a coach of the first team more than to be like in control of the Yacht Academy.
Well, let's say at after a few
what
years
of
no, it's not about what you prefer. After a few years being an academy director, you want also to develop and make your next step. That step for me was to be together with Barak and to mentor Barak also a little bit in okay, yeah. This is the way you develop players or you develop coaches and to make sure that we grow the club further and also to bring more the academy and closer to the first team. And this was something that was interesting for me without, right, because then you have to take about the next step for me would be or to be sport director. Yeah. And I never closed the door because I took the pro license in Ukraine in 2009 with the intention to help the club to get a better evaluation as an academy, but also for me to take the opportunity that if somebody opens the door to evaluate if it's possible.
And Donny started the season, he did well on Europe. Then the league started, it was a mess, we saw it. Even though the result in the beginning was a little bit shaky, we saw that it's not like something that, we didn't see a path of football mm-hmm. from Donny's. So he got dismissed and you got the job. But I want to ask you about, because you haven't commented on that, I think, since you left Maccabi Tel Aviv. When Donis left Maccabi Tel Aviv, he said on an interview that he felt that you and Barak are pushing him outside of the club, so you will take the job as the head coach. That was an interview that he gave to Yaniv Tuchman at that time. Mm-hmm. I want to hear your version to that story.
No, we at that time, because let's say we were part of the search for a candidate, we gave it to the management. And after that, our job was to assist him in getting the best opportunity and so on. Because my job was not to follow the first team in all activities. That was Barak's part in let's say, in the football department that Maccabi Tel Aviv created. So we were together at some moments. We were evaluating our situation, what we wanted. Are we going in the direction? Simple thing, are we playing 4-3-3 or 5-3-2? So these are the things that you evaluate, which is not done by us. And as I said before, to start the season as a coach was for me an opportunity to show the academy coaches, if you ever come to a first team or get any opportunity, it doesn't matter what you do, you can do the same.
Yeah.
It is how you bring it and how you explain it. So in that period, we just shared our opinion also with him. Barak was close to the players. He came from that group. Yeah. So he could share the feeling of players with the coach. And this is merely what we did.
So Donis interpreted it like you are trying to push him out. When you told him this and the players
Donis
don't
put
like
himself out. Not
if I think well, what you say is correct. His international campaign, let's say, was good.
Yeah.
And but it didn't match with the league.
I know.
And his luck in the COVID period was only one game each round. So you make quicker success if you
easy draws until the
yeah. If you make a good draw, yeah, then. Yeah. So yeah.
So you took the job, you won the cup. Is this the best moment for you as a coach, the cup, or not?
Well, I must say that the best feeling from that period was the winning of the games, and the winning of the games with different lineups, mm-hmm. because more or less, if Kandil played or Geraldes, it was no different. David Zada or Saborit, and this was more or less. Coming from the tight schedule, 3-4 days,
yeah,
And at that time, the group was with the right quality of being able to still play at a high level with different types of players. And that was the biggest pleasure, because there you could see that working every day with the team, mm-hmm. And players more or less flipping the coin, will I play tomorrow or not on a Friday, yeah. Was giving a lot of motivation and a lot of good feeling within that team, that everybody was part of it.
I must say something. It's interesting that you're saying this, because also when you was like on the Yacht Academy, for you, there is never like first 11 and that's it. Always you really care about also the other players, and there is not substitution players and the first team. You take care that like for everyone. You want them to play. You didn't want to lose anyone.
On a youth academy, I think up to under 17, you cannot demand every week to play with the same 11. I think, yes, under 17, I look at it from 16 years old, you can make your debut in the first team. There are players that could be ready.
Yeah.
Okay, in Israel, I think it's less than in Europe, but you should be ready. So there, a coach has a little bit more opportunity to play the first 11 more often. But still, substitutions have to be done. Yeah, I remember at my discussions with at that time Uri David about a player, Ofek Sassoon, mm-hmm. central defender, tall guy. Yep. You have youth players that, if you are close to 2 meters and you have to play against 1.50 meter players, sometimes you can look bad. But if you play against 180, 190, you look good. So I wanted to show Ori that the player should have more opportunity to play. And he looked at me. I said, okay, you don't believe me? Okay, send him to me. So that was on the 19 to first team, Ofek Sassoon. Yeah. He made his debut in the whole group of the Toto Cup. And I showed him, and I spoke with him after. I said, Ori, you have to trust more in qualities of players, and sometimes to look beyond what you see on the field. You have to look at the qualities. And these are sometimes moments for coaches to understand, yeah, I have to trust one player more, or I have to trust my team more, to that they are able to deliver a higher quality. Because playing, let's say, young in Beitar Tel Aviv, or playing with under 19 against second division, yeah. with under 17 against under 19, is part of the development and part of the trust that a coach gets in his players.
I will take you now for the summer of after the winning the cup.
Mm-hmm.
You got the appointment as the head coach regularly, yeah. not as an interim. And it was after a good finish to the season, even though it ended without the championship, but the gap was bigger when you came. And you spoke about the Twitter before. I got at that summer a lot of feedbacks from players inside of a dressing room, saying, like waving some red flags, that this won't work, that if Patrick stays the head coach, we will not succeed. And most of the complaint wasn't about your football style or something like that, it was on the personal level. Some of them felt that you are treating them as they are still in the youth, in terms of maybe being too stiff with them, maybe, I don't know, something about the dynamic group wasn't working. And they raised that red flag very on, before even training camp. It resulted at the end by, you know, what happened. The team didn't succeed. Many things, it was because of the poor situation in the dressing room. And I was the one writing a lot about it, as you know. And we didn't hear, I think, even once, your reaction to that, your comments to that.
Well, first of all, let's say like that. I think a player of a professional team is paid to play football. And part of a top club means also that, yeah, you have to do what is asked. I believe that players are part of a team, but also have to show their qualities. And I think that players, without asking who, mm-hmm. were players that are playing less. Because this is the way. This is the way you get your information. It's not from the ones that are playing. Yeah. Because these are the ones that get the attention and more or less deserve the attention and deserve to play. you mentioned the name of your colleague journalist
Yaniv.
He told me once that for you guys it's only your festival or balagan that is giving you the information, so I know that it will come and I know from which players it will be. And for me, or not to speak to them or to being stiff or what, it's for me it's a reason that I cannot do a lot with, because they don't come to me.
Okay,
so to speak after is for me not polite, or it doesn't help me to comment on players. It doesn't help me because I will not change the player and the player will not change me. And that I'm how to say it, strong or demanding or strong in my opinion, I don't think so, that I'm that strong that players cannot perform. I think a player needs to look at himself. Do I give everything that I can? And that is something that
no, but there were other players that did spoke by their name. One of them was Tal Ben Chaim.
Yeah,
he said that you were misdoing him wrong and you didn't respect him and that you froze him. And
listen, I think that you mentioned a player that that should be lucky that I keep quiet.
Why is that?
Well, let me stay quiet because I don't think that I don't think that let's say he could, we pushed him in certain situations because you want more out of a player. And I think he grew up in a generation that they decided what to do on the field, and I'm not from that generation. I think that you have a responsibility, and pushing a player to be in a position to score, I think should benefit him. And this was more or less situations where you need to push players, and I'm not there to be friendly. No, I'm sorry. And this, and mentioning this name, I don't have nothing to say to it. It says all by itself, the point of his career.
In your eyes, what were the reasons for you not succeeding at the following season, after the first 6 months? You were at the end of the day 10 months overall in that job. Six of them was really good. The next 4 months wasn't. What was the difference?
And this I don't agree with you.
Okay.
I will tell you why I don't agree. First of all, we were successful in Europe. Still doing a lot of good things, pushing. I don't think that the team was, let's say, ready to perform that well on both levels. I also think that a lot of clubs and owners decide too quickly if something is not going well. Having the experience myself as a coach by taking the team in a position that was not leading, but bringing it back and still regretting not to take the championship also, because that was still possible. But we lost it in a game in Kiryat Shmona where we got the red card and we lost the game. If we didn't get the red card with TB, we finish the game, we win the game, we would still be on the way to have, let's say, the double. So I think that a little bit more time in correcting the situation in the league would have been the best, because this is what I believe in and which is what I think would be possible.
But you haven't felt that the atmosphere surrounding Kiryat Shalom is not the one that you can succeed.
Okay, but you have this is what at that time we spoke about. We had, let's say, 1 month until the next window to clean up, and
so that was your plan. If you
that was the thought, and okay, any player that didn't perform or felt that he needed to move out, you had an opportunity to let's say refresh the group. I think that a little bit more time, a few weeks more, would have been easy, because if I look at facts, I think the coach that finished the season, I think even was on the second position with 1 point more or 1 point less.
He finished third.
Then when I went out, You understand? So this are things
but I must say that you lost against Maccabi Netanya in Netanya Stadium.
Yeah.
And I was there, and when I saw Barak and Sharon leaving from the stadium, I saw the faces. It was clear for me that it will come to an end now, that they will not wait until January. So in that discussion with them,
yeah, no,
what did you hear? Listen, expecting you to do different, or I don't know.
No, I don't know what at that time these two persons could have told me to do differently.
Okay.
One without any football background and one just starting from let's say changing his point of view as a player to a manager. Well, that game we lost. We should have scored 2, 3, 4 goals in the first half. We outplayed them. We didn't score enough. We catch a goal in the second half, and Netanya with defense get the enthusiasm into the team, and you totally lose control.
Yeah.
And that is something that, of course, it cannot happen. It will happen in any coaching career. But at that time, you should have finished the game already in the first half.
Yeah. So you didn't get any feedback from Barak telling you, listen, let's try to do something else and bring back this team together? It wasn't any discussion regarding that at that time?
No, I don't remember any okay. discussion that would lead to, let's say, a situation of not being able to work together anymore. No.
Let's speak about Shakhtar and Zorya.
Yeah, no problem.
How do you sum up your time in Ukraine totally?
After Maccabi, I had some time. I have still a lot of let's say good contacts in Ukraine. Ukraine is like Israel, a country where you still can develop football and teams. A country that started because of the war and the total football situation changed. All foreigners left. A lot of clubs having to use academy players or first division players or second division players to create teams to still participate. Zorya opportunity came at a moment that there was some interest from other clubs, but it was the most concrete one. And the one where I knew the club as being a club that always wanted to or was able to play in Europe. At that time, they also had difficulties making the team. So we started with a lot of young players, a lot of players that, let's say, played in the previous seasons, 8 to 10 games maybe in other clubs, but had the talent coming or from Dynamo Kiev Academy or from Shakhtar Academy. So it was an interesting start. I also there, it was a little bit like I had 1 month to prepare them for the qualification for Europe.
Yeah.
Like similar style of working as the 1 month in Maccabi to do it. We need to change the style quick. We need to make it a team of a group of players that never play together or come from the under 19 or come from reserve teams. And that connected. And like some difficulties in scoring goals, in creating a lot of opportunities that didn't work out in the first part of the season. We were, let's say, on the run of maybe going into the winter break for the first position, but making 2 draws brings us back to the third position. But going into the winter break with a lot of positive feelings, like if we can connect, let's say, our defense a little bit better to not giving goals away, we have an opportunity to score more goals and to get back and to stay in the race. Worked out well. We did the preseason. We had some difficulties in the second preseason by having an incident on the training field of a player receiving a heart attack. So more or less all the positive that you were building drops a little bit. A lot of team feeling came inside because of this incident. We started the league. At that time, we also brought Eduardo Guerrero. So we knew that the striker that we were missing, we would have now. He came, I think, 4 days before the start of the first game. We start the game. We are 2-0 down after 20 minutes. We come at the halftime. We go and we speak a little bit direct to the players that everything we did and what we showed in the first part of the season, we need to do now. We get back into the game, assist of Eduardo, 2-1, 2-2, and we make 3-2 before the end of the game. And we start also there a very positive run. We had 15 games in the second part of the season with only 2 losses. Mm-hmm. So we secured the third position, making it possible for Zoya to even participate in the Europa League.
Yeah.
And if they would lose, they would be automatically in the group stage of conference. So that was a good position for the club with, at that time, an extra income from UEFA would be welcome in the time of war. I went with the intention to do well, knowing that the club would be, do well or give me the opportunity to do well to see if I maybe can make mm-hmm. the other clubs interested in me as a coach. We did well. There was some interest, and at the end, Shakhtar asked if I was interested.
And you worked for Shakhtar before. We need to say that.
I worked for Shakhtar before, so I was in older period that I was not at Shakhtar.
They knew you.
The new Patrick, yes, the head coach Patrick, yes.
Not the old Patrick.
Okay. Not the old Patrick. Okay. Yeah. So. From one come to another, Shakhtar, knowing Shakhtar from, let's say, the good period, because also they had to make a lot of changes because of the war. A lot of talented Brazilians left, used the UEFA ruling to get out, and they also needed to start new. With the younger team, younger Ukrainians, talented Ukrainians, after they became champion, also they... I wanted to change the style of football, still to continue with bringing in younger players and also younger players from scouting too. So we started on the job with training camp in Holland the first 2 weeks because of the under-21 championship and qualification games for the main national team. After 2 weeks, I had only the full group.
Okay.
Which was more or less 1 week before the start of the league, because there was only a 3 week preparation until the first official game in the league. There also, like we discussed about Maccabi, some quest changing the style, bringing in some players. Also there I started with, okay guys, this is the way I want to play. We have enough quality to bring it. To dominate the 90 minutes in the game, in attacking or in defending, but we need to deliver quality. From that point of view, I also train because I want everybody to be fit enough to be dominating the game, and also in Europe, because Champions League is a different story. We start okay in the league, we take some points, we dominate parts of the game, but we are not, how to say, dominating the 90 minutes as I would like to see. Had some injuries in preseason of players that are important for the team. They are young, but they already had some seasons in professional football. Some of the transfers didn't work out as we planned, so a different quality of players came, younger. Some of them coming also from a different background, so a different training background. There were some difficulties, but we took our points. We were, let's say, in the first position of the league. Still, we lost already, let's say, some points that we shouldn't have lost. Starting the Champions League in the league from the first position, the first Champions League game against Porto, not in Ukraine, but playing the games in Hamburg, in Germany.
Yeah.
So meaning that the traveling for every game continues. Very good team to play. So as a coach, you try to eliminate as much as possible the good qualities of the team. We lose the game, but we showed some opportunities for us to score. On 1-1, we make 2 mistakes. We give them an opportunity to score another 2 goals. And in the second half, we had 1 or 2 chances extra to score. Continuing in the league, come the second Champions League game against Antwerp. We start we start bad in a way of that we don't show the aggression that we needed. At halftime, you try to correct and to...
And you won.
And we win 3-2.
Yeah.
With a little bit luck, because they get a penalty in the 93rd minute, which they don't score. So we take the first point in the group stage, so from two games. And more or less after that, it starts in a way that I get some... I have my ideas of continuing, of developing. Players go to the national team after the Antwerpen game. The club was able to move the league game to gain some extra rest. We have a friendly game. I planned a friendly game for the players that that are not part of the national team. Mm-hmm. We play the game, we win. We have some difficulties 10 minutes in the beginning. It's a friendly game. Hmm. We end with 7 players of the under-19 in the second half. So I think a good job. And the next day, the general director called me. He said, listen, the president didn't like the friendly game, so...
But you won the friendly game.
Yeah, yeah, but you have to understand that this is not the reason.
What he didn't like?
In the way the team played or the team performed.
Wait, he sacked you after a friendly game?
Yeah.
More or less, this was... this was this
that's
was what,
unusual.
This is what is told to me.
But what, what's the real reason in your eyes?
The real reason, okay, yeah. I think I shouldn't share. Hmm. But, okay, this ends. And you start the season knowing that there are more demands. You also start the season where you think, okay, we need to build something together. And this is something that at the end wasn't...
you were first place in the league when you got fired?
Yeah.
And now they're not first place.
They are first now.
Now they are first?
Yeah, but they had some games to...
Maybe from this weekend they are first, maybe. I think,
yeah.
Before they were second.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, end of the story. So, let's say a second spell of...
The life of a football coach. It's not how good you are. There is also another things.
You have a lot of things in a club like that.
But
is around the team.
Yeah.
That is not directly happening on the field.
He left Shakhtar on a successful period.
Yeah,
when he left Maccabi wasn't reaching the goals that he should have been. That's different.
It's the same for me. It feels in the same, because more or less you have to see through things, and if you're doing well, you're on the way. In the point of view of let's say Maccabi, the results in Europe, mm-hmm. you would be first or second. That was the direction we were going in that group, and in the league. I still think that the points to overcome and to get back into the top as Maccabi Tel Aviv, you always have, because you have a more quality group. In the way of Shakhtar, I look at it in a similar way. You're starting something which will go with ups and downs. If you need to change things, it will go with ups and downs.
Yeah.
If the things around it are in the let's say, the noses are in the same direction because we want to achieve the same, then you will achieve it. As soon as somebody is interfering, it becomes a different...
So you have the next few months to yourself. What is your next destination? Step. Where do you want to find yourself now? As a coach, as academy, sport director?
No, I am, at the moment still focusing on continuing the coaching career, the head coach. There are some showing some interest now. As I said before, the contract with Shakhtar will officially end in 1 month. So that gives opportunities for me to continue. Mm-hmm. Anything that comes now that gives me similar circumstances, I'm ready to start. I spend my time wisely in visiting clubs and watching training sessions and games to add some interesting things to your personal philosophy, in my case.
Was it correct that last few months you got approaches from Apoel Tel Aviv and Apoel Petah Tikva as a head coach?
No, I am no, nothing now.
Okay. What do you thought about the decision of Barak Yitzhaki to become a head coach of Beitar?
Well, I think that it's what he wants. So I think that he needs to start now. So, yeah.
You felt it when when you were the coach of Maccabi Tel Aviv, you felt that you want to be the coach someday?
No, not directly, no. We spoke about it, I think, a few months ago. He said, well, more or less, okay, what do you think I should do? Should I continue as a director or as a coach? And I said, listen, if you feel that you can want to influence a whole club, you need to be the director. And if you want to work with players, then... Okay, you need to start finding out.
And as you know Barak, you think that he's going to succeed in Betar Jerusalem?
Well, he always told me he's the king of Jerusalem. So after his playing career. So I think that...
I think Eli Ohana is the king, but maybe he's the prince.
Okay, the crown prince. But I think that his knowledge, I don't want to, let's say, give myself credit, but that he saw... okay, this is what is needed to organize a club, an academy, or a first team, that he knows what to do. Okay, now he needs to get the chance and to take the chance. And knowing Barak, he wants to be the best. He wants to be very ambitious and playing in a certain style of football. But okay, I advise him to take the time and to be smart in it.
Well, you're surprised that he didn't take the job after Ivic left? Before they brought Karanka?
He could. Before Karanka,
I don't know.
It's better in Maccabi than in Beitar, I think. No? In terms of...
Well, yeah. I would look at the challenges bigger in Beitar Jerusalem to create something with a huge potential still as a club.
I mentioned the name of Ivic. I think also he said something about you a few, maybe 1 year ago or 2 years ago, also in an interview. That you were the only one he didn't spoke with at his time in Maccabi Tel Aviv, and he felt that you are not giving him respect. Do you know what he meant when he said those things?
No, I don't know.
You didn't have any problem with...
No, why I should have a problem with him? If he was not in touch with me and I was not in touch with him, then okay. I think that... I remember that I was invited to a dinner when Ben Mansfort started and he started as a coach, that I was part of it. So that we met, me as an academy director to be part. And at the moment that a lot of young players like Cohen and Glaser and certain, Pivan came back from all the loan period, so to say. So I think that I visited the first team games. I cannot remember that he visited an under-19 game or any youth game that was 100 meters away. So I think if he says that we didn't speak, okay, maybe look at yourself and maybe take the interest and take it to heart. Maybe I should show some interest. Yeah. I think that that's something I try to do as a head coach, is always to show some interest in an under-19 or an under-17. I knew all the teams, I knew the schedule. Yes, for me, it's easy to cross the road and speaking to the coaches, because more or less you develop them or you hire them. But I think also in Zorya and in Shakhtar, I try to be interested in what's happening. And people know my background, so they ask me also questions or ask me to be like an advisor. And in Zorya, it was like that. Zorya only had an under-19 and they had an academy. Mm-hmm. Playing on a different location, but more or less the under-19 was the only team where I as a coach could take players from. So you try to watch the training sessions, you try to watch because they trained at the same facility. So you try to have an interest or speak to players, use players in training sessions, use players in the friendly game. Yeah. So yes, this is part of me. I think it needs to be inside you also as a head coach to show interest in the other side.
We sit here on a Sunday. On Thursday, Maccabi Tel Aviv won Olympiacos 4-1. We saw in that game, in the lineup, players that grew up in the academy, Ido Shachar, of course, Revivo, Dor Peretz, Kanikovsky. We saw coming in from the bench guys like Turgeman or Karcev, Davida, that was until he was 15 years old. Mm-hmm. When you see all those Israeli guys, some of them you know personally better than us, and you saw that game, how many of them can play on a Champions League level team like Oscar right now? How many of them have that potential to go to those type of teams?
Well, I think that all of them, let's say, that play have an interesting position. Roy Revivo as a left defender. The whole football world is always looking for left defenders. So I think that he has that extra. And I think that he's developing in a right way to get the minutes and to get the games at every level, in the national team also, etc. So he gets at a young age a lot of experience. How he manages it or how they manage him in the sessions is most important, that he keeps this, let's say, high discipline in focusing on being the best in that position. Dor Tuğman, I think that he can be a little bit more, I don't want to say selfish, but to be more quickly in scoring the goals, because he gets always, or he creates always opportunities. So he needs some time, but yeah, he needs to
What do you think he needs to improve on his game?
I think he needs to think less and to finish quicker. If I see him go at the goal, I don't see his actions being, where am I putting the ball? It's, where's my defender? I need to still make one move. I would like him to be, let's say, more taking Zahavi as an example. When the ball is ready, it's ready to fire. And this is what he needs to start doing so that his statistics go up. Because he needs the goals. To be talented is nice for a certain period, but now it's time to be effective and to bring the goals. And for that, he needs to, of course, be in the best position for him possible as a striker.
Yeah.
But again, if you have two good strikers, you need to manage it as a coach.
You mentioned before on one of your answers that there were some players in the youth that you are surprised didn't make it. Can we go into names? If you want to go into names, who surprised you that didn't make it to the first team of Maccabi Tel Aviv?
Well, we cannot only speak about players that didn't make it, but also players that didn't get the chance. I think, mm-hmm. for example, Guy Mizrahi is a player that I personally saw making progress a lot, and I think he shows it now in Netanya that he's on the right track to keep developing himself. I think Maccabi Tel Aviv, after selling Oscar Gloch, should have taken a different decision with Barlin, for example, player that's now on loan in Hapoel Haifa.
I told you about it.
I think he's
amazing.
He has something specific.
Yeah.
He has also something specific in his head, but it's a very good boy, very, how to say it, unexpected decisions with the ball, mm-hmm. and not a lazy boy. So I think that some players should have get the chance. But okay, he now has the road to show it through a different way.
The second year with the under 19 was not good for him.
For all of them, for all
no,
of
no, for all of them, team. For all of that team,
for
you know,
Cordova also for,
all of the, for all, also for Bayern and for a lot of them, but in the second year he was supposed like to go to another place to play like in adult game.
Mm-hmm.
You think about Berlin?
I think that also partly it lays in and what happened in the academy. But I think that that generation of players didn't only consist of Oscar Gloch. I think there are some more players in that group that Maccabi will benefit from in the future.
Yeah.
Claudio Braga was something that you brought to the table or no?
It is related to me. Yes, I suggested Claudio also because I got the request not only to be the head coach, but
yeah.
to continue also to look after the football philosophy in the academy. And for that, you need a person that let's say, follows and follows the plans that were already existing for 4 or 5 seasons.
He didn't follow them.
He after me leaving, more or less, things changed. And that that is something that that Maccabi should look at by themselves, how to handle that in the future situations.
Yeah. Who do you think will win the title this season? Maccabi Tel Aviv, Maccabi Haifa?
Well, let's say like this. I think they are compatible at the moment. I think it depends also who made the best transfers in the winter period. Mm-hmm. I think Haifa, after the start with the young coach, came back into the race. Both teams surprised me with the long period they are in Europe. So yeah. for the league, it's good that both of them have the same more or less schedule, with the opportunity so both of them to qualify for the next round. So that's only top for Israeli football. So I think it will be a race until the end.
And who do you think did the best January transfer window when you look at...
I think they did different transfer window. Maccabi aimed for the younger players, yeah, maybe for the long term.
Israeli.
And Haifa brought in some young foreign player and also some experienced Israeli player. So I think that both of them looked at expanding the squad with quality to be able to participate in the two leagues that they are in now, in the Conference League and in the Israeli league.
You always said, and I remember that with the years that you had the academy director, I think you did the first interview with me as the academy director, you always said that the Israeli talent is something that is not getting enough attention, that we have here a lot of talent and we just need to direct them on a good way. When you see now the level of the Israeli players coming out, and you see Maccabi Haifa with Anan Khalili, who is a top player, what resulted in that change, that we are now making more good players from the youth than previous years?
Well, I think that that of course the younger coach coming from the youth helps. Mm-hmm. Maccabi Haifa to recognize some of the talented players and to give them the opportunity. This always helps when a person comes from the academy or knowing the academy players. He will quicker say, listen, we don't need, I can try it with this one. Mm-hmm. So that is a plus. I think also the performance of the national teams last summer also made people in Israel realize that, yeah, we need to have some more trust in the younger players that we have. So let's hope that continues. But at the same time, I hope that not only the Israeli Federation continues to create a high level of coaches development, but also that clubs are starting to pay attention more to the academies.
Yeah.
I still think that children in Israeli youth football don't have the right facilities to play football, not enough opportunities to become better. Also the extra activities of clubs investing in, yeah, they need to see it. If each club would see one player being sold to Europe with the amounts of Daniel Peretz or Oscar Gloch, then you are creating your budget for your academy and you are creating your aims for your academy, because you need only one.
Yeah.
And to invest on your level in an academy to increase the activities of children is something that needs to happen. If last Saturday or yesterday I watched the under-19 game, I think there needs to be more demands. There needs to be a higher tempo. There needs to be more intentions to dominate the game for Israeli children to grow up.
Yeah.
Because everybody that is, let's say, involved in Israeli football or supporting or knowing the talent, yeah, is waiting for the national team to qualify for something. And this would be the biggest boost.
Yeah.
But if this boost goes to all the owners of the clubs or all the owners of the academies, that is something that that should go. And because for such a small country, I still think there are a lot of interesting players. We mentioned some of them. I'm looking at Israel as scouting opportunities, which players clubs are not using.
Yeah.
Is it a player that I still believe in to make better? And this is something that that I, of course, hope that Israel will see it here.
You also proved that we can attract younger guys that can be good players, like Eduardo, like Parfait. So that's another direction that is possible for the Israeli football that we are not using it, I think, in most of the teams right now.
But you need people that believe in young players and young coaches, and you need people like this.
Yeah.
Well, I understood that the most of the clubs now are not taking a young foreigner because they get a certain compensation for the federation.
Yeah.
And I see it from the point, the same as in the first team, a foreign boy brings something extra to a youth team. So it's compete.
In Maccabi now, we don't have a foreign players in the youth for a second season in a row. So that's...
Yeah. No, and I think that, let's say, Maccabi and the scouting of the youth showed that they are able to find the players. Right? Because it started with Willy Agada to take him on loan from Hapoel Jerusalem. Then we bring Eduardo. Then we bring Parfait. With Parfait, we still had another... Bamba was also in that group, but you'd need to take decisions.
Yeah.
And Parfait was standing out the most at that time. Then we had Novatus Miroshi from Tanzania, who also added something to youth football. Played at that time in Beit Tel Aviv, second division, and did the preseason with the first team. So I think that it is an extra opportunity, and I don't think you should let it go as a club because of finances. Because maybe it could be more, or maybe the Israeli Federation should stimulate it and maybe even increase a second one.
Do you have something more before I will finish it? Oren,
what?
Something more to ask while you finish the interview?
No, I just want to you to succeed and to have a good luck wherever you choose in the next club, which any position that you choose, and that's it.
Thank you.
When we are asking an Israeli person or a Jewish person where he comes from, we always say, okay, I'm half Moroccan, half Polish. I'm half Bulgarian, half from Germany. Can we say now, after all those years, that Patrick Van Leeuwen is 15% Israel?
Well, let's say like this, that I am with pleasure in Israel. I worked with a lot of pleasure here. A lot of friendly people assisted me in being successful and creating also a name for myself here. So yes, I am... 15%, yes, maybe it's...
Maybe more.
Yeah.
I have another question.
Maybe you should ask for the passport.
I have another question. After all of what you got in football, what do you think that you need to improve in yourself, if there is something like this?
No, that's also part of this period, to look at yourself. And I'm not afraid to listen to people. I'm not afraid to get their opinion. And to take something from that. If I look at myself, but then okay, maybe communication or personal contact could be.
Okay.
But for that, you have also nowadays a much larger staff. So certain things you leave to your assistants, because at the end they also need to do something. You cannot do everything by yourself. That's why
you have the analyst. But when you are the manager, you do everything.
You plan everything
and
you decide everything, but your input comes from your assistants that are with you on the field. And this is something that I look at more closely now. And what I like to evaluate is the communication between the head coach and his staff, the head coach and the players.
Okay.
But also the assistants with the players. Okay. Where is a head coach really involved in the training session? And for that, I travel. And I like to see the training session. I'm not traveling for exercises. This I can create myself. I'm traveling to see communication between coaches and players. If I go to Betis Sevilla and you think, okay, after the training, they will go inside. They did their job. They go inside. Okay, one of the players is still unhappy that he doesn't, that he didn't play or that he didn't participate enough. So I see there a 70-year-old coach, Pellegrini, with a lot of experience, speaking for 20 minutes with the player, trying to comfort him, trying to make him believe in his qualities, that he gets his chance. So all over the world, the same situations occur. And also, if you then speak with the coach after, because these opportunities you also get because of the clubs that you work for, is that he also explains this is part of it, okay, and still at my level players are not understanding why they don't play. Mm-hmm. And one word is not enough, you need to spend time on it. So yep. This is something that
it's even more important than tactics, the communication and everything. Sometimes it's important than tactics.
If they listen.
Yeah, if they listen. If you make them listen.
Can be.
Okay. Patrick, thank you a lot for coming.
Welcome.
Wish you all the best. And we will follow your career, of course, and see what happens in the next few months.
Okay.
Maybe we will see you on the lines in Bloomfield soon, yeah. But as an opponent. Who knows?
Everything is still open.
Yeah.
And we will see. And the sun is coming, so this is perfect.
Okay. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you.